Welcome back to Restorative Justice. This week, I'm going to be lecturing longer than normal because I'm going to be asking you to get creative with me. The first part of our class, you have been introduced to the best and the worst of our retributive justice system in the United States and restorative discipline in the schools. Restorative justice as it happens with victim-offender mediators, and most recently, truth and reconciliation at the international level. Now, my interview of one of my alumni, Mukarema from Kenya, built on that truth and reconciliation process to be exploring restorative justice within a community, a society, a nation state that was colonized like Kenya was with all the resultant harm. What I would like to be turning to these last few weeks is looking at our relationship with Mexico. Many of you, your family, your parents, grandparents have been born and raised there. You know, this California, Baja, you know, California, we have sort of blurred boundaries between what was formerly Mexico, now United States. And it's not a simple restorative justice analysis, but it doesn't need to be. Concerned community is as much a part of a restorative process as the victim and the offender. And you saw that with truth and reconciliation. And I want you to consider it here because I will be interviewing alumni working with relatively poor Mexican working class community in South Central. And I will also be interviewing an alumni who was born on the border in San Diego. Her father worked in Mexico, and her negotiation, conflict resolution, and mediation work have been both in Mexico and the United States. And they are a way of giving you a taste of a broader analysis. Let me turn to my PowerPoint and talk a little bit more about how I want us to get creative. We are in a time where, you know, we are in the United States and around the world more polarized and divided than arguably we have ever been in my lifetime. And there is a great deal of hatred. Sadly, prejudice continues despite all the efforts that people have made over generations to try to eradicate that prejudice and bring communities closer together. Given the times that we are in, human-to-human encounter, getting to know each other on a personal level is more important than ever. And figuring out how to do that in a safe, respectful way is critical. Now, when I interview alumni Martha Sanchez, her focus is on empowering, you know, the poor working class citizens, community, arguably the victims, right, of necessary restorative justice. But she's focused on empowering them. She's not looking at bringing together those who have harmed them or those who currently harm them and having human-to-human encounter. But I'm introducing this because that her human-to-human encounter, a graduate of Dominguez Hills and with a major in negotiation, conflict resolution, and peace building, and I think right now she's gone on and gotten her master's in marital and family therapy, that's a powerful human-to-human encounter. She is a role model, an inspiration, a mentor, a coach. These are all ways that we as concerned community can work to empower victims around us. Arguably, we're all offenders and victims in this life. We all do harm. We've all harmed despite our best efforts. And most of us, if not all of us, have been victimized. Years ago, one of my Chicano students of negotiation, conflict resolution, and peace building shared publicly in class that he had been raised to hate African Americans. That was actually a very courageous and vulnerable human-to-human encounter because he was in a classroom with many African Americans. And in that moment, he was opening to having a conversation about, his cultural group level, how he had been raised to think about other human beings who he was now relating to. And I see that as an opening, an admission that he wanted to heal and change the hatred and the prejudice that he had learned. Now, an interdisciplinary program, and that's what negotiation, conflict resolution, and peace building, the umbrella program for this restorative justice course is inherently creative. And it always brings together people from different cultural, faith, religious groups together in a more intimate experiential setting because we don't just lecture to our students. We don't just test you or ask for papers. We don't just assign reading. We build communities in our classroom where you get to practice multicultural and interfaith community, empowered gender relationships, empowered transformative masculinity and femininity. That's what we do in our classrooms and our community together. I myself, when I was an undergrad many years ago, I was an undergrad in a faith-based college for the first 2 years of my studies, and service learning was a regular part of my education. I was an activist with Bread for the World. I was invited to live with a migrant farm worker family in the housing projects. And I got to know the children, 10-year-old Rosa, Juan, Manuel. I got to know them intimately on a day-to-day basis. I lived with them as part of their family. I got to experience their experience of poverty, being looked down upon. As I lived with them, was treated in many ways the way they were treated. It was a transformational learning experience. It affected me for the rest of my life. I got to know the father well enough that he told me his shame and his despair in becoming disabled and no longer being able to provide for his family as a farm worker. And, I don't need to explain to you how this has shaped my entire career, this transformational learning experience. I hope while you're at Dominguez, you are having similar experiences with other cultures, with other people living a different class, a different life experience than the one that you've experienced. It is an important part of learning how to do restorative justice in a very intimate way. Now, Rosa was being solicited by pimps, by Johns on the streets of her community. I know trafficking of human beings is happening throughout LA. My first scholarship was on the trafficking of children, particularly girls. But having been working at Dominguez Hills and living in Long Beach for the last 20 years, and having worked with in treatment gang-affiliated kids, I know that we must work as a concerned community, as concerned families, to protect our children from the local gangs. Now, I mentioned Paramount here because it's the most successful gang prevention intervention program that I've seen based on my students' research. They involved parents in opening the parents' eyes to the risks that their children were facing on the streets of communities throughout LA County and beyond. I mean, Riverside is San Bernardino. I don't need to explain to you, this is a widespread concern and issue. San Francisco, it was, you know, Vietnamese and Chinese run gangs. So this is an issue throughout California. We must involve concerned community and concerned family as much as we can. The Archdiocese of LA, for those of you who are Catholic, approached me very early on about doing restorative justice for their communities. They, in the Archdiocese, in the Catholic community of Southern California, the victims include the victims of crime, but also the families, the parents, the spouses, and children of the offenders. And they wanted a comprehensive restorative justice program that addressed all of these groups and all of their relationships. Now, Mexico itself is an incredibly and increasingly violent country. Now, I'm not comparing. The U.S. has horrific, heart-wrenching, tragic violence that keeps increasing. But I want you in the last few weeks, as you are debating and presenting your optimal approach to crime, to consider all countries that concern you, not just your local community, not just your current life, but how can we work with transforming violence and restoring justice in all the countries where we have loved ones, in all the countries to which we're connected by ancestry. Years ago at a peace and justice conference, I met the father of one of the young men who had been kidnapped after protesting against the government of Mexico in his state. I think they were undergraduates, were kidnapped. Freedom of speech is much riskier in Mexico than it is here. And these are just, you know, this is just one of the issues or a few of the issues that I encourage you to consider. In order to do this, we must consider a legacy, you know, a deep, dark history of injustice, of harm done to many peoples. And if I just focus on Mexico, you look at the Catholic Church, you look at, you know, you look at Spain, and I could do a different analysis with the U.S., but I trust you can do it yourself. We must go back in time and ask ourselves, how do we restore people? How do we repair the harm that was done to them? How do we restore and repair relationships? There's a lot of long-term systemic work that must be done. Now, most Americans don't know the history of California, of, you know, Mexico, the Mexican-American War. So some of you might enjoy educating some of your classmates about the history, about some of the reasons that so many Mexicans come to the United States, apart from the obvious economic opportunity, some of the historical reasons. And this is some of restorative justice, enlightening, educating communities. I think it would be wonderful, you know, in California, we have more, you know, my students have different names, they labels they prefer. You could say more Hispanic Americans, more Chicanos, Chicanas, you get to decide whatever you know, name, label you prefer. But we could, in California, start to write certainly a Mexican-American narrative in order to start exploring how we can build a future together for all people. Now, I say a future that looks forward here, but I have no problem with going back in time as we explore harms and what is needed to repair and restore. But my main point is here, let's come together and start to write some new collective narratives. You know, some of you, your ancestry is Central American. I'm not going to go all through all of your identities, but this applies to all of us. How can we come together rather than, you know, having a dominant American narrative? How can we have a multicultural, interfaith, inclusive narrative that acknowledges all of our realities and experience and respects and values, all of us? We are actually going to be, last I heard, with modern languages, NCRP is going to be starting a minor in Dominguez Hills for those who want to develop their Spanish-speaking skills to a professional level to be working as translators, interpreters, mediators, advocates, bridging Spanish and English-speaking communities. I would love to see this happen with even more languages. Many possibilities. Now, there are many creative alternatives that concerned communities, victim offenders exercise when they're looking at the real-world problems we face on a day-to-day basis today. For example, many of my students who are parents have moved their children away from gangs. They have moved their children away from dangerous neighborhoods and schools. I am a big advocate with victim offender mediation for first-time juvenile offenders as the most effective way to prevent repeat crimes. I mean, there's really limitless alternatives that we need to test in the real world to ensure that they actually work and make the difference we're seeking. Restorative justice is a movement that was started by victims. And so that's the spirit I would hope you would bring to these last few weeks, that sometimes those who have been harmed have the most energy, enthusiasm, and motivation to be creative, to speak up, and to create new pathways. Now, I'm going to do a quick review in this longer lecture because we are getting near the end of the course. Key components of restorative justice are offenders who admit and want to repair the harm they've done. Now, that's a big, you know, criteria. And any ways that you can work with offenders to help them become open to taking responsibility for the harm that they've done would make an enormous difference. You know, let me talk just very briefly about all the diversity training and the affirmative action we've been doing during my lifetime, trying to make a difference. I don't actually believe that these efforts have done enough because they do not include human-to-human encounter. Courageously coming together, creating a safe space, and eradicating prejudice and helping offenders know the harm they've done by meeting the human beings they've harmed. I think these are some of the paths that we need to do more to actually catalyze the justice we're seeking. We need to come together person to person. And you're receiving some of the tools and ways of doing that here. Victims who want to meet offenders represent the best of this, right? They are the courageous victims who say, I want them to know how they've harmed me. And I want to question them about why. You know, I want to ask them to take responsibility for repairing harm. These courageous, empowered victims can be the key difference to whether restorative justice happens or not. And then, of course, they negotiate repair of harm, and oftentimes impacted, concerned family and community are as involved in this process as the victim, as the offender. And in your analysis, when we're looking at Mexico-U.S. relations, you know, neighboring, you can say offenders, you can say victims, you can make this as complex as it needs to be. Now, I want to give you a couple of other alumni. You've seen, if you've watched them, interviews of several, you will see a few more. But I want you to know of a couple that I never had a chance to interview on one of the Dominguez TV cable shows, who are doing really important work. Ray Rigaldo is with the LA Human Relations Commission, and he is working with Spanish-speaking communities throughout LA County, doing restorative justice, community mediation, a wide range of human relations work. Kathy Shimizu is with, last I looked, the Orange County Human Relations Commission. And Alejandro is working in Long Beach with the California Conference for Equality and Justice. And I don't know how Long Beach is doing today, but during the pandemic, I was researching the escalating violence and crime we were seeing in various cities and communities throughout LA County. And I was very pleased and impressed to learn that my own city, Long Beach, somehow had distinguished itself from neighboring cities throughout LA County, where everywhere else violence was increasing. The efforts of Long Beach, like the California Conference for Equality and Justice, were somehow reducing violent crime. And I would love to have some of you reach out to our alumni and explore why, exactly what are they doing. But I know the California Conference for Equality and Justice is embracing restorative justice. We have talked about transforming school cultures. You have heard several interviews with alumni and others who are attempting to do this. I believe what you're learning here is the way to go, the path forward with eradicating violence from our schools. Now, I've talked a little bit about this already. How do we transform prejudice throughout the U.S. and Mexico? Now, you know, cross ties are what we have in common. And let me stress one. We have the extreme distance between the most wealthy and the poorest in both countries. And we also have isolated communities, arguably segregated communities. They don't cross class. They don't cross, color. And that's a discussion no matter which country you're talking about. There are shades that are recognized and have significance in both. We have to figure out how to bring people together so that they can transform the existing prejudice throughout. Now, this is something I'm raising because it's an issue that not only concerns Mexico, it concerns countries like China. I can name a whole list with our very diverse, you know, country with many first, second generation immigrants, a lot of Americans who have lived here longer especially the conservative. There's not a lot of them in California. There are some. But a lot of them are terrified that the more recent immigrants to this country are not going to be loyal to this country first. They will be loyal to their countries of birth, of, you know, language, of culture. It's a complicated discussion. I'm not saying, I'm not taking one side or the other, but it's critically important we figure out ways to come together and talk about how do we build a future together. Now, when we look at making victims whole in countries that have been colonized, both of our countries, as well as many countries around the world, we need to look at historical sense of harm and wrong and ask, how do we make people whole? Not just economically. There's been a real focus on money, and it needs to be part of the conversation. But there are many other ways that we can come together to restore relationships and make people whole. And I hope you will start to consider them. Victims and communities need to have a voice. This can't just be something that government or churches or some other authorities decide to do for us. We need to all figure out ways that we're going to come together to do this. Now, many criminals and offenders are also victims. We have addressed that already in this course. Hurricane Carter was primarily a victim who had been repeatedly victimized. But you have been introduced to I would say, you know, the Truth and Reconciliation process in South Africa, offenders who were part of the communities that were being victimized. So it gets complicated. It gets messy. And we need to be able to embrace all of it when we have these conversations. Now, you are being asked in this class, those of you working with Living Inspiration, to look at your own restoration, your own inner healing process. Every human being has to figure out how they are going to heal and restore themselves as well, and then empower themselves so that they can be a strong part of this process. I would like for this class to be a launching pad for you to reach out to some of the Dominguez alumni and others actually doing restorative justice mediation and other types of restorative justice throughout our communities and ask them, what is making a difference? What is helping to move us forward? What critical gaps do we still have? What is needed? What do you find most inspiring? I've only been able to give you a tip of the iceberg of what's happening here. So please, you know, bring back to class, bring back to me what you learned. I would love if any of you are connected with juvenile diversion, you know, like the alumni, Jared Butler, who I interviewed, to hear if they are working with restorative justice. Are they doing victim offender mediation? Many programs are not. Some just believe that all juvenile offenders need is a nice, tough police officer to scare them straight, or a former gang member to scare them straight. They don't realize that restorative justice is proving itself as the most effective intervention. And if any of you are connected with schools, I think more often than not, you're going to be hearing that restorative discipline is not happening in the schools. There is still a lot of work needed with spreading and piloting restorative discipline in the schools. So let us know if you do connect with any restorative classrooms or school districts, school systems, what's working, what's not, what's needed. And then the other thing in LA County, oh my goodness, I have a lot of alumni who are parole officers and probation officers working with offenders. Some are helping welcome offenders back into communities. There's a lot of cool nonprofits, reentry programs out there. I would love to have more of a community discussion talking honestly about how our current system of punishment and prison is backfiring, is ineffectual, is not working. Now, some of you have served time, and you have a success story to share. We have many of those success stories at Dominguez. They are welcome, too. But we need to have conversations to figure out how to reintegrate better. You know, sometimes offenders come from communities that encourage their crime, that benefit from their crime. They need to find other communities. And sometimes communities exercise, you know, the throw out and exclude, exile the offender. They're not welcome back. So they need new welcoming communities. I have had many offender students, and I have these conversations regularly with them. I hope you will join me, asking and learning from them what helped them transform their lives and turn away from crime. You know, students who've grown up in gang-affiliated families. These are very powerful stories. We can all learn a lot from them. Some of the experience in prison is restorative. That is, you know, Prison Internationals with my good friend Daniel Van Ness is doing a lot of restorative justice work in our prisons. So it's not all negative. Some is very positive and life-affirming. At the same time, crimes are being committed in the prisons. Offenders are being victimized in the prison. Criminal networks are being formed and strengthened. So these are the complicated considerations and discussions. Enough, I suppose you're saying. But, you know, I'm very passionate about this subject, so I want to encourage you. I want to provoke you. I want to ask you to join me. I do believe restorative justice can make a huge difference in this world and in our local communities. Thanks for sharing this interest with me. Take care. Until next time, and I'll look for you on campus.